Good afternoon. My name is Bill Burkwhite, and I'm the inaugural director of Perry World House. Thank you for joining us today for this celebration of the opening of Perry World House, a new hub for global affairs right here on Penn's campus, just up the street on Locust Walk, and a research program dedicated to providing relevant insights and research on some of the world's most pressing problems. Part of what Perry World House will do is exactly what we are doing here today, convening some of the most knowledgeable and experienced minds in foreign policy from Penn, from Washington, and around the world together, away from the bickering of the Beltway, to reflect, to enlighten, and perhaps even agree on something. If you like what you hear today, or even if you hate it, make your way over to Perry World House this year and dig into some of the issues that will be brought up in the conversations this afternoon. Apply to be a student fellow, come to our speakers and events, organize your fellow students interested in issues that motivate you, and use the beautiful new space, the ribbon for which we cut this morning. Now, Perry World House would not have been a reality without the leadership and vision of President Amy Gutmann. I want to thank her for her support every step of the way in getting Perry World House open and off the ground, for her trust in us to build this new institution, and her continuing guidance along the way. So it is my honor to welcome to the stage Penn's visionary leader who has charted Penn's course to a global future, from the Penn Compact 2020 to the new Penn Wharton China Center, and now to the opening of Perry World House, an exceptional scholar who has helped our country and our world better understand deliberative democracy, political ethics, and the value of education. Perry World House only exists because of your vision, your dedication, and your extraordinary leadership. I'm honored to give you the 8th president of the University of Pennsylvania, Dr. Amy Gutmann.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. It's great to see you all here. And it is a wonderful day for us here at the University of Pennsylvania. So we are Penn, and this is the day to celebrate Perry World House. So we want to do something that is both big and also that has a truly global perspective. And that is why there is no better person to get us off on exactly the right track, somebody who has a big perspective that is an American perspective with a global, huge global experience and a global perspective. And so we are very pleased and honored to welcome Robert Gates to Penn today. Dr. Gates served as this nation's 22nd Secretary of Defense from 2006 to 2011, and he is the only Secretary of Defense in the United States history who is asked to remain by a newly elected president, serving in both Republican and Democratic administrations. Prior to becoming Secretary of Defense, Dr. Gates served as president of one of our nation's premier public research universities, Texas A&M. I got to know Dr. Gates in that role. We are both members of the AAU, the American Association of Universities, and since we're seated alphabetically, we got to sit next to each other, and that was my great privilege. And he has gone on to do so many things, including being the author of two books, which if you haven't read, you must read. He is the author of Duty, Memoirs of a Secretary at War, and also most recently, the author of A Passion for Leadership, Lessons in Change and Reform from 50 Years of Public Service. Dr. Gates has won more awards than we have time today to recognize, but I do want to recognize one in particular. He is the recipient of America's highest civilian honor, the Presidential Medal of Freedom. We welcome Dr. Gates. He will speak with us briefly, and then he has agreed to engage in a conversation with me and to take questions as well. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming a great leader, public servant, and really a wonderful person, Dr. Robert Gates.
Thank you, Amy. I'm honored to be present here today for the dedication of Perry World House. I know it will be a hub for Penn's global engagement as the university addresses a wide range of international global challenges in a truly interdisciplinary environment, and I might add, in a really beautiful building. The dedication and opening of Perry World House comes at a propitious moment. I believe that we are at a point where the world is more perilous than it has been at any time since the end of the Cold War, and more complex, perhaps, than it has been at any time since the end of World War II. A number of leaders around the world had hoped a few years ago that the world was moving in a direction of a dominant collaboration and cooperation among nations where the rule of law would prevail. Unfortunately, some key actors in the world didn't get the memo. To wit, in the Middle East, we are seeing a combination of conflicts that I believe likely will lead to a generation of violence and continued terrorism. Four conflicts going on simultaneously. Shia Islam led by Iran versus Sunni Islam led by Saudi Arabia. Secularists versus Islamists. Reformers versus authoritarians. And then the broader question of whether artificially created states such as Libya, Syria, and Iraq, comprised of historically adversarial tribal, ethnic, and religious groups, can actually hold together, or whether they will splinter, as happened to Yugoslavia. Of course, Syria is, in some respects, the epicenter of all four of these conflicts, and also a center for terrorist groups, along with parts of Iraq. In Russia, Vladimir Putin has not gotten over the collapse of the Soviet Union, which he has termed the worst geopolitical disaster of the 20th century, for which he blames especially the United States, but the West in general. And I think Putin has two broad strategies. One is to return Russia to the global stage as a world power that must be reckoned with in dealing with almost any issue in order to deal with it successfully. The second is, and generally wherever he can, at the expense of the United States. And second, a strategy that in some ways is as old as the Russian Empire, and that is to create a buffer of states that are either friendly to Russia or are frozen conflicts on the periphery of Russia. And this explains what's been going on in eastern Ukraine, the covert and overt intimidation of the Baltic states, and the things that have been going on in Moldova, Belarus, Transnistria, and elsewhere. In China, the Chinese are attempting a very difficult transition from an investment-based economy to a consumer-based economy. In addition, it faces a number of internal problems ranging from environmental disasters, corruption, separatism, terrorism, demographic challenges, and more. President Xi has gathered more power to himself than any Chinese leader since Mao Zedong. This enables him to have control, but it also means that if and when things go wrong, he is likely to be blamed for it. Under his leadership, under his presidency, Chinese foreign policy has taken on a decidedly more nationalistic tinge. including exaggerated claims in the South China Sea, the Sea of Japan, and elsewhere, both territorial and economic, leading to the potential for conflict in those areas. With respect to North Korea, we have a leader who is developing nuclear weapons and ballistic missiles. He already has ballistic missiles that either now or very soon will be able to reach most targets in Asia, including most U.S. military forces that are stationed there. And almost certainly during the term of our first president, of our next president, during their first term, will have the capability to launch a missile that can reach the continental United States. And finally, Iran, while the nuclear deal has delayed their acquisition of nuclear weapons, it clearly has not changed in any respect Iran's hostility to the United States, its willingness to challenge us in the Persian Gulf, its desire to eject us from the region, and its meddling in conflicts throughout the area. To successfully address these and other international problems, I think requires American leadership, ingenuity, and new thinking. The old approaches to dealing with these problems are insufficient. Places like Perry World House must be serious resources for new ideas, new approaches, and new tools to address these problems. I believe that I want to wish you all the best of luck and all success in making Perry World House a center of excellence and innovation for international problem solving. Thank you.
So thank you so very, very much. I'm going to begin by asking you a question which only you can answer, not that because it reflects your amazing experience. So Bob, you go back to many, many presidents, right? All the way back to Johnson, I believe. Yeah. You've written a book on leadership. And you have a passion for leadership yourself. And I'm wondering if you could reflect on any observations about the different, how the unique personalities of the presidents that you have observed and served, how much of a difference do their personalities make?
I think their personalities make a lot of difference. And I think contributes to either success or failure. So just sort of to take several of them. In some ways, of the eight presidents I worked for, Lyndon Johnson was the most tragic. Here was a man who was committed to making a difference in this country domestically in terms of poor people, in terms of racial harmony, in terms of advancing the country, and yet got trapped in Vietnam. And ironically, this man who appeared so self-confident and so powerful lacked that confidence in foreign policy. And he was terrified of being characterized as the man who lost Vietnam. And so was got into what we all know. I think in a way his ego, he had the biggest ego of all the presidents that I worked for. One time he hosted a stag dinner at the White House and he asked Bill Moyers, his press officer, to ask the blessing. And Moyers began to pray, and a few seconds into the prayer, Johnson lifted his head and said, "Bill, speak up, I can't hear you." And Moyers, without ever lifting his head, said, "Mr. President, that's because I'm not speaking to you." Johnson, I think Nixon was probably the strangest of all of our presidents.
I'm glad to hear he was the strangest.
And it's interesting, there are very few anecdotes about Nixon. Mm-hmm. And the irony is, here's a guy who's a conservative Republican, a noted Cold War hawk, and yet he leads the opening to China and detente with the Soviet Union. He's actually more liberal in domestic affairs than most people remember. He created EPA, for example, and a number of other domestic agencies of that sort. Gerry Ford, in some ways, was the most underestimated. He was very courageous. He was politically very smart. And frankly was prepared to sacrifice re-election to get us past Watergate by pardoning Nixon. And I think someday he'll get the credit he deserves for that. Reagan was probably the most visionary of the presidents that I worked for. I skipped President Carter. President Carter did a lot more in foreign policy than I think he gets credit for. He obviously is noted for the Camp David Accords and so on. But I believe, and I wrote in my first book back in the mid-90s, I believe the Soviets hated him more than any president since Truman, and mainly because he denied their legitimacy and his human rights campaign, his support for Andrei Sakharov and so on. There is one funny anecdote, a personal anecdote with respect to Carter. And I usually frame it this way in talking to audiences. I say, and there was one president that I had to tell to zip up his pants. And I usually pause and say, no, not that president. And it actually was Carter. He was getting ready to go out and give a speech on a balcony to 10,000 Egyptians in Cairo. And as a junior staffer, I noticed his fly was open. And I kind of rushed up to him because it was just seconds before he was to go out. And the Secret Service was tensed up, and Brzezinski, for whom I was working, didn't know what in the hell I was doing. And finally, Carter, you know, kind of shielded him as he fixed himself, and he kind of smiled that Jimmy Carter smile, and I explained to Brzezinski why I'd nearly gotten shot.
He owed you a lot.
Reagan, as I say, visionary. I think he was one of the few people in his own administration who actually believed that the Soviet Union would collapse or might collapse during his lifetime, and that he could give it a push. And there are lots of Reagan stories, but the one talent that Reagan had that was especially evident in the first term was this almost Lincoln-esque ability to take a very complex subject and make it understandable to the American people. And one of the ways I could tell he was aging was beginning in 1986 or 87, he would begin telling these stories, but they kind of didn't have a point at that point. Bush, I'll just say one thing about Bush 41. There is no precedent in history for the collapse of a major empire without a major war until 1991. And someday he will get the credit he deserves for having managed that in a way that, first of all, contributed to the collapse, but also avoided a major conflict. Of all the presidents since 1964 that I haven't worked for was Bill Clinton. He was the only one I didn't work for. And I think that Bush and Obama are both recent enough that everybody here knows most of them about them.
And you've written a lot about them. So you and I have shared the unique privilege of leading major research universities, and I came across a quote in your book, A Passion for Leadership, which related to your time as president of Texas A&M and how you got hired. And I want to ask you about it because I think it resonates beyond higher education into the world of global affairs, but only you can tell me whether this is in the back of your mind. So here's what you wrote. If a leader is not making at least a few enemies along the way, he must not be doing much. So I just wonder, is there a story behind this quote, and what's the lesson there? Because obviously we don't intend, the lesson isn't make as many enemies as you can, but I know that I've told my leadership team, if everybody loves you, if everybody agrees with you, you're not doing enough. So what for you is that about?
Well, at Texas A&M, there's an old line that goes, to avoid criticism, say nothing, do nothing, be nothing.
Yeah.
And if you're going, the whole point of leadership as opposed to management is having a vision of a future that's different from what the status quo is. And being willing to take chances to lead an institution into that future and bring people along with you. And there, it's inevitable. Nobody likes, or there are a lot of people who don't like any change in the status quo. And so that's something that has to be managed. And at the end of the day, you have to realize that you're going to have to offend some people. I'll give you an example from the Pentagon. I believe very strongly in accountability. And I believe also that when the lives of young men and women are at stake, that if you don't have the best possible commander in the field, then it's unconscionable not to make a change. But if you think about all of the mistakes that were made in Vietnam and Iraq and Afghanistan, when I relieved General McKiernan in Afghanistan, he was the first American field commander to be relieved since Truman fired MacArthur. And that's wrong. That's not accountability, and you're going to offend people when you do that. Now, my adversary, if you will, at Texas A&M happened to be the governor of Texas, Rick Perry.
That's what I suspected that.
Perry had, in fact, promised the presidency of the university to somebody else.
Yes.
But he hadn't counted votes on the regents. And he called me and actually tried to, after I was chosen as the finalist, tried to intimidate me out of, to get out of the running.
Right, he basically asked you to drop out, right?
Yeah. Well, he basically told me to drop out.
In my part of the country, that's called chutzpah, right?
And he said, nobody wants you to come. I'm going to appoint all the regions. It's not going to be fun, and so on and so forth. And I said, well, I'll just let the regents decide. What I actually did was go home and tell my wife about this. And I said, you know, what really annoys me is that I was meeting with the head of the first chief director of the KGB when this guy was first elected to the House of Representatives in Texas, and he thinks he can intimidate me? So I became president of Texas A&M on a 5-3-1 vote. And let's just say the governor and I maintained a publicly civil relationship, but he's where he belongs, dancing with the stars.
But I would underscore that you maintained a publicly civil relationship, and that is not only to your credit, but it's so important for our public life.
Yeah, we actually, I don't think we ever disagreed in public or took each other on.
Well, you didn't at least call each other names in public,
we didn't call
right?
each other names. And,
right.
But I think it is important that a leader set an example in terms of restraint and so on. And, you know, in some ways, the paragons of that for me were both Ronald Reagan and George H.W. Bush. I mean, these guys had some serious political enemies, but they never let it get personal. And, you know, go figure that Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill would be really good friends. Yeah. And Bush had a lot of friends on the Democratic side in Congress from when he'd served up there.
Right. And the friendship, or at least the relationship between Reagan and Tip O'Neill was absolutely essential for tax reform on the domestic side. So here, I have to ask, given everything we're living through now, about terrorism and the global order, and let's focus on ISIS. Are we making, in your judgment or your knowledge, are we making progress in the fight against ISIS and global terrorism? And are we making enough progress as far as what our capacity is to fight it? And what are the limits, do you think, as well?
Well, I would separate it, Amy, into how are we doing against ISIS and how are we doing against terrorism.
Okay, fair enough.
And I think we are in the process of dismantling the caliphate, if you will. And where we are today, frankly, in my view, is where we should have been 2 years ago in terms of air power, in terms of special forces, in terms of embedded advisors with Kurds, Sunni tribes, and Iraqi army units. A lot of the president's advisors were urging him to do these things 2 years ago, and I think we would have made more progress had that happened earlier. And as I wrote the other day, I think when you look at the platforms of the two candidates, they're basically calling for a policy that's very similar to what the president is doing, but maybe with, as I put it, more starch and more ideological fervor. Mm-hmm. And so I think ISIS will eventually be destroyed as a caliphate. But I think part of the problem that I have with government is the difficulty it has in thinking two or three moves out. So what's going to happen, the next panel may end up talking about this, but the Sunni cities that have been liberated are in ruins, and there is no money, no plan, and no will in Baghdad to rebuild them. So what happens to that whole part of Iraq? How does Iraq hold together? The Kurds clearly have occupied territories that didn't belong to them before. And is the Baghdad government, how are they going to deal with the Kurds? So I think we are going to face some second order consequences from the conflict against ISIS that will be very challenging. In terms of terrorism, the problem is that as the end approaches, I think that ISIS basically will just dissipate. The members of ISIS will dissipate into the general population. And so we are still going to have, I think, a continuing major problem emanating from the Middle East in terms of terrorism. We have, I think, less of a problem in this country than the Europeans do, mainly because many Muslims are much better integrated in American society and are much more willing to cooperate with law enforcement or report radical imams or radicalization efforts and things like that. And frankly, that integration is central to our national security, in my view. And so I think that's important. But I think we're going to continue to have a problem with alienated, mainly young men. You will have lone wolves in the United States. You may have some effort to put together plots against this country, but that's been very difficult in the last 15 years. And I think you will see more organized efforts in both the Middle East and in Europe. So this is going to be a continuing problem for us to have to deal with.
Say something more about the European refugee issue now with Syrian refugees and other refugees. And is there something that the US is not doing that we should be doing? To what extent is this our problem? To what extent is it, do you think Europe needs to solve it on its own? Where do you think where's the progress that can be made in what is really one of the largest refugee problems we've had since, if the largest since World War II, right?
I think that a big part of the problem was that the immigration flow really got out of control before anybody had seen it coming and before any mechanisms were put in place to try and regulate it or make it more gradual or to make sure that people were political refugees, if you will, and not simply seeking economic betterment. And frankly, when you allow a million immigrants to come in a very short period of time, one of the things that has happened in this country over the last century and a half is gradual assimilation of immigrants. And so the second generation speaks English and they have the aspirations that people who were born here have and so on. But when you have a magnitude of people like that thrust in all at once, and so you have lots of people coming into small villages in Germany and in the cities and so on who are not culturally attuned to Europe or Western civilization, I think you've seen some of the problems in Germany. So, you know, I think there are some things the United States can do to help, but fundamentally, I think this is a problem the Europeans are going to have to deal with. I think that the immigration flow, thanks to the agreement with Turkey, has largely gotten under better control, but you're beginning to see the backlash in Europe, the losses that Chancellor Merkel has just had in recent elections and so on. So, and this has fed the far right in France, with Marie Le Pen and in various other places in Europe. So I think it's an ongoing problem for Europe, for the EU. And frankly, I wish I had a solution that would make it, you know, you could say if you just would do these things, it'll all turn out okay. But I don't have that solution.
So I have to ask you about something that unites the two candidates for president. Both Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton opposed the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a trade deal, as you know, negotiated by the Obama administration with key nations other than China in the Pacific Rim. And critics argue the deal would hurt American jobs and American workers. So proponents say that this is about promoting continued American leadership in the Pacific in opposition, among other things, to Chinese hegemony. So I really think it would be great if you could explain to us what you think failure to ratify this pact might mean. Would it be a step back from global leadership? I'll put it in a very pointed way. Would it be the American equivalent of Brexit in the sense that we are now turning isolationist? What's your view on this?
Well, I don't think it would be of that magnitude, but I think that more broadly, let me step back. I think what American political leaders and economic and business leaders have failed to do is explain to the American people why globalization, A, is inevitable, and B, how it benefits most Americans. What they have also failed to do is to try and identify those Americans who have lost their jobs because of these, as industries have moved out, and figure out ways to help them transition to new kinds of employment. So, frankly, when it comes to international trade in general, I think there's been a failure of leadership in both parties to both explain better what's going on, but also to provide assistance to those who are being left behind by the changes that come about. I think that if there had been no Trans-Pacific Partnership agreement, you know, it's kind of, I don't think it would matter. The problem is now that it's up there, and the president has made a big deal out of it, failure to get it approved will be a loss. It will be, in my view, kind of an easy political and economic win for China. Now, I would take another step back, though. I think we haven't been very creative in how we've dealt with the Chinese on these kinds of issues. I think it was a mistake for the administration not to join the Chinese Infrastructure Bank. All our allies did, and what we need to be doing is looking for ways to work with China to further integrate China into these international relationships and international organizations and so on. And you know, I think we ought to step back. All the international financial institutions that were created, Bretton Woods and around that time, were all created at a time when China didn't matter economically. And why not offer to step back and host some kind of an international conference? How do we update these institutions to reflect the second or first largest economy in the world, and to make it, to give it a role that is accords with that economic importance? So I think the failure of the Trans-Pacific Partnership will be seen as a loss for the United States. I think it'll be mainly a loss of face. But I also think it then gives China opportunities with these countries to develop their own relationships that will negatively affect us.
So at the same time, you think it's important to assure Americans that this isn't about the loss of, on balance, the loss of jobs?
Yeah, I frankly think that it's in terms of the, I mean, frankly, the last several administrations have allowed the narrative to become predominant that globalization and international trade is a net loss for the United States. And that, as I say, is a failure of leadership.
So I'm going to turn to some questions that I have from Penn students. But before I do, I know you have a passion for leadership and a passion for public service. And you believe that it's really important for young people to do so as well. And we certainly believe, as Ben Franklin's university, that we want to be educating our students for service. And I wonder what advice you have for students who are looking out at public life these days and maybe saying, as some students said to me, I really want to serve my country, but I'm looking and I'm wondering, can you get things done in public service? So you have gotten things done in public service. What's your advice to young people who are aspiring to hold positions in public service? Because we like to think of ourselves as educating leaders, and certainly if I say the best, if anyone is feeling depressed, come to Penn's campus and talk to our students. It's the best antidepressant. It doesn't require a doctor's prescription, and it works for me and so many other people. But I'm sure our students and faculty alike would love your advice on how do you prepare yourself for public service, both intellectually and psychologically.
Well, first of all, I spent nearly 5 years interacting with nearly 2 million young men and women, most of whom are the same age as undergraduates. And overnight, I went from being a university president and seeing people 18 to 25 walking around campus in flip-flops and shorts and t-shirts to seeing people the same age in full body armor carrying assault rifles and so on. They are, for me, the epitome of public service. They are putting their lives on the line, and they're frankly putting their dreams on hold in many cases so that students back here in this country can pursue their dreams. And I've seen young people in CIA, I've seen the young people at Texas A&M. I don't think there's ever been a generation more eager to be in public service of some kind. And it doesn't all have to be at the national level. There are lots of ways to serve. And there are lots of different organizations in which you can serve. So AID or the Peace Corps, Teach for America, is as important as going into the military or going to work for the State Department and so on. So the first thing I would say is there are lots of venues out there where you can do and accomplish really important things and let the storm clouds of politics sort of just float by and not have to worry about it. I would tell you that the more practical advice I give to young people is you're going to have some patience. You're going to show up and you're going to look around and after about a year and say, you know, I can run this place better than anybody that I'm working for. And as I told the cadets at West Point, in the course of your career as a young person, you will inevitably work for a jackass, because we all have. And you just got to power through it. And remember that there are some real opportunities. The other things that I would suggest is, first of all, you're going to need to be a risk taker. You're going to have opportunities presented to you that are not part of your plan.
Yeah.
And if you're so stuck on your plan, you're going to miss some amazing opportunities along the way. When I first went to the National Security Council in 1974 to work for Henry Kissinger and Brent Scowcroft, my bosses at CIA told me that there probably wouldn't be a job for me when I came back. Most of them were still there when I became director. So patience, risk-taking, but you really have to follow your passion and just don't let the politics get in the way. Look, I went to Washington in the middle of the Vietnam War. I was there through Watergate, through the assassinations, through all kinds of horrible things. And, you know, I've always liked the analogy that Thomas Jefferson made, that a despotism is like a clipper ship. It's very fast and very efficient and very fragile.
Yeah.
And democracy is kind of like a raft. It's always about 2 inches underwater, but it's damn near unsinkable.
That's fabulous. I love that analogy. Here is a question from a senior in political science, Itai Barsaid. Are you here somewhere? I will read it. I have it here. You recently wrote that a current challenge is to confront and stop Putin's aggressions while pursuing cooperation on international challenges that can only be addressed successfully if Russia is at the table. So here's the question. How would you advise a future president to approach cooperation with a country's interests that seem so diametrically opposed with those of the United States?
Well, first of all, I would say I would advise differentiating between the interests of Russia and Russians and Putin. Putin's basically an authoritarian. He's a dictator. He's a KGB guy.
Mm-hmm.
President Bush famously said that he had looked into Putin's eyes and seen his soul. After my first meeting with Putin, I went back and told President Bush I'd looked into Putin's eyes and seen a stone-cold killer. Russia is buying this nationalistic fervor that he uses to basically distract the Russians from the fact that their lives have gotten worse since he became president this last time. And so I think we cannot afford to attack Russia in a political or economic sense, as opposed to trying to take actions that have impact on Putin, on his circle,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and on some of the things they're trying to do, like with their military and so on. I think it's hard to make that distinction sometimes,
mm-hmm.
but I think we don't want to put ourselves in the position of considering the Russians our enemies. Putin is our adversary,
yeah.
and I think that needs to be the focus of how we look at it.
And somebody recently said that Putin is a strong leader the way arsenic is a strong drink, right? So it sounds like that's what you're saying. Really, we have to oppose Putin as opposed to opposing the whole country.
Yeah, Putinism is not in Russia's interest. And so how do we grant Russia its proper place as a great power and acknowledge their pride? I think, by the way, we dramatically underestimated the magnitude of the humiliation for Russians of the collapse of the Soviet Union, in part because it was also the collapse of the Russian Empire.
Correct.
Russia today basically has the borders it had under Catherine the Great. And just imagine the United States losing three or four of our largest states and what the psychological impact would be. So we, I think, have to be a little understanding of that and keep our focus on the actions that Putin is taking that are a serious problem for the United States and our allies.
So a student fellow at the World House, also a senior, Lewis Davis, asks, now that you are on a college campus as the chancellor of William & Mary, what suggestions do you have for institutions like Penn's Perry World House, and more broadly, students and faculty at universities across the nation, to bridge the divide between the ivory tower of academia and the policy community in Washington?
Actually, I think a number of universities are doing some really good things in this respect. And it is through organizations, institutions like Perry World House, where you have representatives from the academic disciplines across the different colleges of the university, blended with adjunct professors or people who come in to lecture or to teach who have had practical experience in government agencies or as political leaders or whatever, in order to bring this blending of sort of academic background with practical experience. Because it's the academic research, it seems to me, that begins to offer some avenues for new ways of doing things where the practitioners actually can learn from that. But I think also faculty and students learn from the practitioners, here's how it really works in the real world. I always used to joke in the four and a half years I was president of Texas A&M, I never once was invited into a political science class. And I always figured it was because the professors were afraid of what I'd say.
Well, this is, I think, a perfect way to end our session, because you have articulated something that is in the spirit of Penn and certainly the aspirations also of Perry World House, to bring together people who have experience not only in Washington but all around the world in public affairs at the local and global level around the world, together with our faculty, our students, and have fellows. And there's no better way to have begun, Dr. Robert Gates, than with hearing from you. And we all wish you the very, very best in continuing with your passion for leadership. And I'm sure you have inspired everybody here today and will continue to contribute so much to our country and the world. Thank you so very, very much. Please join me in thanking you.
Thank you, Amy. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
And we are now going to roll. We're going to roll a little video about Perry World House. So here you go.
So while our panel is being seated, I just want to say a huge thank you again to Secretary Gates and President Gutmann for that fascinating conversation. We turn now to the next 4 years of American foreign policy, and I'm delighted that Perry Worldhouse has been able to convene an extraordinary panel. Will I ask you please take your seats with a wonderful moderator, journalist Michael Crowley. Michael is senior foreign affairs correspondent for Politico, where he has chronicled the Obama administration's policy on issues ranging from Iran's nuclear program to Syria, ISIS, Ukraine, and China. He also writes about the foreign policy views and advisors of the 2016 presidential candidates, several of whom are on this stage. Michael, we're delighted to welcome you as our moderator. I'll let you briefly introduce the panelists and take it from there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. Thank you to President Gutmann and Secretary Gates. What a great conversation that was. And congratulations to Penn on Perry Worldhouse. It sounds like it's clear you're off to an exciting start, and it's going to be a great addition. Let me quickly introduce our panelists who hardly need introductions. This is a real A-team, and we're going to have a great conversation. There's a lot to pack in, and I want to keep it moving quickly. And let me start with Ambassador John Huntsman, who is now chairman of the Atlantic Council, formerly ambassador to China from 2009 to 2011, also ambassador to Singapore, and of course, governor of Utah. Next to him is Zalmay Khalilzad, who is now counselor at the Center for Strategic and International Studies, former U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, also served as ambassador in Afghanistan and Iraq. Fran Fragos Townsend, who is a former White House Homeland Security Advisor under President George W. Bush, also a national security analyst with CBS News. Kurt Campbell is Chairman and Chief Executive Officer and founding partner of the Asia Group, and was Assistant Secretary of State for East Asian and Pacific Affairs in the first term of the Obama administration. Last, certainly not least, is Anne-Marie Slaughter, who is president and CEO of New America and was director of policy planning at the State Department from 2009 to 2011 under Secretary of State. You may have heard of her name is Hillary Clinton. I believe she is seeking higher office these days. Fran, I want to start with you and launch us on the kind of main headline in the news right now, unfortunately, which is yet another terrorist attack inside the United States. We are still trying to figure out exactly what happened in New York and New Jersey, and I think it's probably not a good use of our time to do a forensic analysis of what is known and not known. Probably most people here have been following the news. But in the theme of the panel of the of what a next president can do and expect, my question for you is, what would you tell an incoming president about events like this? It is now this dark, constant drumbeat in our public life. I've lost track going through the list in San Bernardino, Orlando. There was the stabbing in Minnesota also just a few days ago. So is this a fact of life for the next president? The next president is going to have to accept. What would you tell the incoming president to expect? And what would you tell that president to do?
Well, I think I would start, which was never my opportunity when I was in the White House, with the good news, right? I never had good news when I was talking to the president. But the good news is 15 years after 9/11, the extraordinary law enforcement response you saw, look, you had, if you count all of the pipe bombs and all of the stuff, 10 devices, only two were able to successfully detonate. And they captured him in 48 hours. Everybody in the tri-state area used to get weather emergency alerts on your mobile device. You got the FBI wanted a notice on your phone. And within 48 hours, it was one of the tips from a citizen that led to it. And they resolved it. They did the forensics. I mean, it was a pretty textbook perfect response by law enforcement. And that's the result of, across two administrations, a constant investment in our law enforcement and intelligence capabilities. That's the good news. So the incoming president is going to inherit a much stronger system than we had when we suffered 9/11. Here's the bad news. We've seen with our success, right, the bad guys know that we've made it very much harder, not impossible, but much harder to cross our borders successfully. And so they've reverted to using the tools available to them, including the internet, to proselytize, to disseminate propaganda, and to initiate this radicalization process. We're not going to kill our way out of the fight in terrorism. We're going to have to deal with the internet. We're going to have to deal with radicalization. That has been a persistent problem, by the way, across two administrations, right? We have a real hard time facing and dealing credibly with the radicalization problem. We need to do better at enlisting our allies. But the problem, that problem, the ideology, is going to remain a persistent problem for the new president. And they're going to have to find more effective strategies than we have up to now.
I just have to ask a quick follow-up. What is the, I mean, you were in the hot seat. The pressure must be unbearable, especially for someone in your job, but also for a president. You're living life, and every day something could blow up, and everyone is going to blame you. Psychologically, how do you prepare for that? Can you prepare for that?
You know, I was teased by my colleagues. I was perfect because I am a worrier by nature. I'm always trying to imagine how it could break bad. The good news in that is the system is almost geared that way, to expect the worst, to plan for the worst. And I will tell you, regardless of whether it's a Republican or a Democrat in the administration, the person who sits in the seat I occupied, there's an understanding. And for that person, and for much of the apparatus of government that works 24/7 to prevent an attack, every day is September 12th, 2001. And I don't care what the politics are. The people responsible for identifying and disrupting and responding to attacks, it's September 12th for them, regardless of who's the president.
I remember you once told me that you had gone to a major amusement park with your family, and your mind is looking at where are the exits, what are the vulnerabilities, is this a soft target? So I sympathize.
Well, my kids think I'm a killjoy.
Well, thank you for your service. It's a cliche, but it's true. Amory, the other also dark story that's been in the news sort of in our realm in the last few days is just the constant brutal heartbreak and outrage of Syria, which is a conflict that I know you have thought and written and spoken a lot about. Over the weekend, it seems that U.S.-led coalition forces accidentally bombed Syrian positions, unintentionally killing dozens of Syrian soldiers, creating this geopolitical furor. And as if that wasn't bad enough, a couple of days later, an aid convoy that was supposed to be part of this very fragile ceasefire that was finally going to get humanitarian relief to places like Aleppo was attacked, possibly by Syrian forces, which really seems to me like a new low, even by the standards of this horrific conflict, to have an aid convoy attacked that way. Can the next president make any more progress than this one can? I mean, here was this ground-out effort to make a deal with the Russians. Maybe this was a breakthrough. John Kerry spent weeks trying to get it, and it lasted a couple few days, and things got worse. Can the next president make any more progress, and what could the next president do to alleviate the suffering and try to wrap this conflict up?
So I am not going to start with good news. I wish there isn't good news about Syria. There just isn't. I think the next president can do more to give the United States some leverage on Russia and on the Syrian government, that many people have been proposing for years now, that the next time he uses barrel bombs, he's using chemical weapons again, that in fact the United States, not alone, but with other states, attack his Air Force, and not take the whole thing out. We're not going to war with him, but we are saying there's limits to how you can fight this. Right now, we have no leverage. It's Russia and Iran backing the Syrian government. There once might have been a chance to really build up people we could support. I think that moment has passed. It's incredibly complicated. So the best that the next president can do is to increase our leverage, to bring people to the table. And the best hope of that, and it's a slim hope, is a fragile sort of stalemate peace, which, you know, if you think about the former Yugoslavia and the Dayton Agreement, you know, even today in Bosnia, nobody likes each other, right? They still hate each other, but they're not killing each other. And that's the best we can hope for. But realistically, at this point, I think it's equally, if not more likely, that you're looking at the civil war we saw in Lebanon for 16 years, but on a far worse scale, destabilizing the region, raising Russia's profile, sending streams of terrorists and refugees into our closest allies, and it's a terrible, terrible situation.
It sounds pretty grim. So for the next president, it's most likely containing the damage more than anything.
Yeah, and I do think the next president can show more muscular leadership, I think, to borrow Secretary Gates's term, which is to say this president has made very clear he didn't want any part of this. But if you travel in the region, what you hear is you all are not here. Now, that's not fair. We are there. We're bombing ISIS. But we have not been there in terms of actually being willing to lead a coalition. So we have Saudi Arabia. We have Qatar. We have other states that are increasingly now talking to Russia, Turkey talking to Russia. So I think we can be there more, we can lead more, and we can push harder for a political settlement. But we're not going to send in ground troops, and the day may have passed where you could get that settlement.
And as a counterterrorism person, of course, these two issues are related. Does that sound right to you? I mean, this because I neglected to mention it in the transition, but these domestic terror attacks are clearly being fueled by radicalism that's being fueled by the Syrian civil war. Does that kind of increased American role make sense to you briefly? And then I want to move on to the Ambassador Khalilzad.
Absolutely. You mentioned, as did Anne-Marie, the serious humanitarian crisis that's a result of this. So I think most people don't think of the refugee crisis as being a US national security problem. I think it is, and I think it's unfortunate that we haven't had it in that context, because these refugees who are fleeing the people we consider our enemies, ISIS. Two, they have on the ground fresh intelligence as they leave, which is difficult for us to obtain because we don't have many assets on the ground in the war zone. And three, if you leave them and abandon this issue and leave it to the Europeans alone to solve, the answer is these people are isolated, abandoned, and they become a ripe recruitment field for terrorist organizations. And so we regard the refugee crisis as Europe's problem and it's a humanitarian problem. I would submit to you this is a long-term national security problem that our children, when they're in these positions of policymaking, will have to deal with.
That's a sobering thought. Ambassador, you were in Baghdad in some of the darkest days there, 2006, 2007, when it looked like the country was beyond repair, beyond saving. It may be the case again, but it improved since then. Can you talk about what you learned from that experience that a new president could apply to this Syrian quagmire, which requires diplomacy that involves Iran, big player during the Iraqi civil war and occupation insurgency. Similarly, the Saudis had a role, all the regional players and the Syrians. Bashar Assad, of course, had his hand in that conflict. So you were balancing so many different regional players. What did you learn from that experience that you would tell a president if you were sitting in the Oval Office, this is what you have to know about this kind of seemingly intractable regional diplomacy and how you go about it in Syria?
Well, thank you very much, and it's a great pleasure to be on this panel. The dark days of Iraq when I was there was not because I was there.
I didn't mean to blame you.
But it was a tough situation, and the lesson that I learned was the importance of security in order to achieve the goals that we had embraced of state and nation building for Iraq. And the difficulties of the security situation in Iraq was in part we didn't have enough troops ourselves, and we had also dissolved the Iraqi security forces. And we were perceived as threatening the neighbors who thought they were next, such as Iran and Syria. And because we had embraced the objective of democracy, building a democracy in Iraq to transform the region, even our friends were not as supportive because they feared the institutionalization of democracy in Iraq. And I think that what we did learn is, however, that with adjusting our approach, which was one of engaging more with the neighbors on the one hand, but two, increasing the forces necessary to improve security, but also to build state institutions, we did succeed. We brought Al-Qaeda in Iraq to a significant degree under control. The Iraqi institution became more capable of providing security, and it became, those institutions, more professional, but with our presence. And with our departure, which I alluded to some of the mistakes that we had made earlier that we adjusted and learned from, but our departure, in my view, a total departure, undermined some of the gains. And therefore, the lesson that I learned, if you take on a project such as transforming a country, it's a very long-term project. It takes a long time. It is an effort that we need to be very cautious about undertaking. My advice to the next president would be, especially doing two of them at the same time as we did, both Iraq and Afghanistan. But at the same time, I would caution not to overlearn that lesson, mm-hmm. not to abandon our capability to assist in building institutions, because if there is a critical issue that needs to be resolved by control of territory by friendly forces, we really have two choices as a nation if we make that decision, if the president does. If you liberate Mosul, if you take Raqqa, if you take Damascus, assume Damascus falls to ISIS, what do you do with that territory? You either control it yourself with coalition partners, or you have to build local forces to do it. I know in this moment that we are very much, as a nation, against state and nation building. It's got a bad rap. While we should be selective, we should avoid doing big state and nation building, I believe that compared to controlling Mosul ourselves or controlling Raqqa ourselves for an indefinite period, controlling a future city in ourselves, we have to be prepared, if we go down this route, to do state building, to help locals do state building. So
the next president, you think, should be prepared to spend more money, send more? There may be, you see different estimates, 3,000, 5,000 American forces back in Iraq now. Do you think we should, the next president should be prepared to see those numbers grow over the next 4 to 8 years?
I would think it would be a mistake to exclude things, mm-hmm. Because you don't know, it's a cliche, the future is unpredictable. We may have to, we would like not to do so, given what we have experienced, but we may have to if, for example, if Baghdad was to fall to ISIS, would we not do more to get rid of that threat? But I would think that with regard to liberating the cities that are currently under ISIS control, Raqqa or Mosul, we already have something around 4,000 plus forces. If they have to increase, we should be able to, but I think they're sufficient. I think the question is not whether we'll be able to liberate these cities militarily. I think we will. After. The question is, what do we do afterwards? And Secretary Gates referred to the problems of these cities that we liberate that are in desperate circumstances. And if you don't address, I'm not talking about only reconstruction, politically, the future of relations between these Shiites and Sunnis and governance issues, you will have, we had Al-Qaeda in Iraq during my period in Iraq, then you have ISIS, you will have the son of ISIS.
Something worse. Quick follow-up on that, then we'll spin the globe to the Asia-Pacific for John and Kurt. What about this question that American force, maybe airstrikes, might be necessary to give us some leverage? Take some shots at the Syrian Air Force, bomb some runways. What do you think of that idea?
I think my colleagues made the case extremely well.
You agree.
That you have to have leverage for diplomacy to be successful, and we do not currently have sufficient leverage.
Well, we'll come back to this region, and Ambassador and Kirk Campbell, you're probably familiar being in Washington with the Middle East and Syria and terrorism chewing up all this time when, from where you sit, what really matters and what I think President Obama has more or less said to people like Jeffrey Goldberg, what he thinks really matters. Jeffrey Goldberg, the Atlantic writer who spent a lot of time interviewing the president, is that it's China and the Asia Pacific that really counts. That's where the global future is, and we get too distracted by these other problems. So let's try to turn in that direction for a minute. Kirk Campbell, why don't I just start with you, and again, thinking about what you would say walking into the Oval Office on day one or during the transition, realistically, is when these conversations happen. In fact, they're already happening now, and you go way back with Secretary Clinton. There's so many ways to look at China. On the one hand, there's nefarious China that steals our cyber secrets, menaces its neighbors, shows these signs of of aggression, maybe even petulance, people sometimes say. But of course, it's going to be the world's largest economy, and we can't ignore it. What is the most important thing you hope the next president understands about China? What is the real China to you? Is it somewhere in between those two stereotypes and caricatures?
Thank you, Michael. And it's terrific to be here, and very much appreciate the chance to sit on the stage with such distinguished folks. I just want to say a word first about the dialogue and then talk a little bit
Please.
About your particular question. I think this is extremely polite and actually quite optimistic in some way. I think the reality is that the president who comes to power is going to face the biggest challenges on the global stage are not about Syria, they're not about China. There are questions that we have triggered ourselves about the United States. And I think if people don't understand that, it would be we would leave the audience, I think, with a serious misunderstanding.
For instance?
Well, I think when you travel through Asia and you ask Asians, what are they really concerned about? They would say, well, obviously we're worried about North Korea. We're worried about a China that is much more proactive, provocative in some circumstances, a China that is no longer content to sit back, that wants a larger role on the international stage and is prepared to push the United States harder. But the biggest issue that Asians, and I would say the same thing is true in Europe and elsewhere, are questions about the United States. So the fundamental issues that the United States has contributed to the world for the last 40 years are in play now. Questions about, are we still committed to our alliances? Are we committed to a non-proliferation regime? Are we committed to trade? Are we committed to defense in the way that we have been in the past? And I'll tell you, and I mean, others may want to comment on this. When I really talk to Asians and others about the world, what really has them on edge is the United States, that we're in a process of reevaluating some of the fundamental things that have made the United States over the last 40 or 50 years. And I think whoever comes to power is going to have to deal with the aftermath of that. And I'm not sure that these are going to be concerns that are easily dispelled or reassured. And so my sense is, and I, you know, like Ambassador Huntsman, I deal pretty regularly with Chinese friends. I think this Chinese leadership is prepared to test the United States in ways that perhaps previous administrations have not been as determined to do. There is not as much collective leadership in China as there was in the past. I think President Xi is a risk taker. I think he believes that time is on China's side. I think it's going to be very important to make the case personally that rumors of American decline are vastly exaggerated, and that over the last 40 years, there have been many instances where countries have counted the United States out at the end of the Vietnam War, at the end of the Korean War, at the end of the Cold War. But in fact, the United States has hidden strengths and staying powers that many people don't recognize. I do want to say just one last thing. I like a lot of what Secretary Gates said. I do not believe that democracy, as it is practiced in the United States, can manage all things. And I do not believe that the institutions in place could deal personally with a leader like Donald Trump. And I think he has the potential to distort the careful balances of power in our system in ways that we can't even comprehend today.
Quick follow-up. And
I just want to pick up on what Kurt said in terms of we are becoming a different country, right?
Yeah.
I mean, many of us here, you know, are white European Americans who grew up on stories of World War I and World War II and the United States as a global leader in the Cold War. You know, by 2030, certainly by 2050, we are a different country than we have ever been. We're majority minority. Being white and being American will not be the same thing. And though all that history, Chinese American, Hispanic American, African American, will be, that is a different view. And so it's not just what the world's looking at. I think many of us are asking, what role will we play as we become a new America?
And I think the way that manifests itself for a new president and a new transition is both domestically, how do you define it, and publicly, what are you communicating? What will America's role in the world be in this 21st century? One quick example of that, it's the same conversation that Kurt is having in Asia that I have in the Middle East. Imagine a head of state private in the Middle East, in the Gulf, saying to me, you know, we don't really want Putin to play the role the United States has played in the Middle East historically, but here's something we know about him. No matter how bad his allies behave, he stands by them. And we don't know that about you anymore. We don't know that you will stand by your historic alliances even when you disagree. And for that level, for there to be that level of unpredictability and a lack of trust with our historic allies is very dangerous.
Well, so Ambassador Huntsman, what do you think of what Kirk Campbell said? I mean, is the problem here, is the most important and interesting problem to do with the United States? Or do you see warning signs that are more important about Chinese behavior in the region itself? Or is it some of both? What's your reaction to his take?
Well, thank you, Michael. It's a pleasure to be with you. And I'm so excited about the Perry World House because I know what it's going to mean for this campus. And you're to be congratulated on it. I think it's just superb. This is a little bit like a homecoming because I love this campus. I've worked with Anne Marie. I've worked with Kurt, with them and for them. And it's just a real honor to be able to reengage on the stage. Yeah, I would say the world is going through multiple transitions. We're going through our own transitions here domestically, from the old to the new, the old world in which we grew up without the benefit of technology to the world that Anne Marie just described. And I was thinking of my daughters, one from China, one from India, as I watch them kind of come of age and how they see the world. And in my lifetime, I've seen us go from a bipolar world to a unipolar world to now a multipolar world. I mean, that's just the reality of where we are. We're losing trust in institutions, evidence of the Brexit vote vis-a-vis the EU, and we're going to see more of that, I think, over the next year with elections in Europe. And as it relates to the other side of the Pacific, Kurt is absolutely right when he says one of our biggest challenges is right here at home. And I tried to argue, although unsuccessfully, while on the campaign trail in 2012, that unless we get our own house in order, we're never going to have an effective foreign policy. We can't radiate the values that we all come around. Now, whether we're Republicans, Democrats, or independents, we all buy into the idea that we speak to certain values as Americans. They're just transcendent, and the rest of the world recognizes a lot of those values as being almost universal, and they aspire to some of those values. We don't radiate those values when we're broken and divided and incompetent at home. And I'm not making that as a partisan statement. I'm saying, look at the Harvard Business School study that just was released last week about the dysfunction in Congress. We can't do the basics And if we can't do the basics, we're never going to be able to radiate the strength and the majesty that we have here in this country. In China, they're going through their own transitions. They're now entering their fifth generation of leadership. They've been through Mao Zedong, Deng Xiaoping, Jiang Zemin, Hu Jintao, and now Xi Jinping. You know, 62 years old, the son of Xi Zongshun, who himself was a very senior cadre under Mao, imprisoned. He has seen China at its most chaotic. He lived during the Great Leap Forward, 60 to 64. He, of course, was sent down during the Cultural Revolution, 66 to 76, to Shaanxi, which left, I think, a deep impression on him as a leader today. So he's seen China at its most chaotic. Does he want to return there? No, he doesn't. But does China have newfound clout and power on the world stage? Of course they do. Do they know exactly how to use and pull those levers of power? No. I think he's experimenting a bit with it, but I think the first issue that comes to his mind is, unless I can rehabilitate the Communist Party of China, we are done. And it's largely because of the trust gap that exists between the people of China and the party. They don't trust the party anymore. It's corrupt. It hasn't yielded the kinds of benefits that people are looking for. There's a lot of incestuousness within. A little bit like the trust deficit we have here in the United States. I mean, I look at both countries and I say, in a sense, we're experiencing some of the same challenges and woes.
So quick follow-up on that. How does an American president deal with that? I mean, we've seen a kind of, I mean, there's political repression in China. You two can correct me if I'm overstating it, but on a scale that we've not seen in a very long time, a very severe crackdown on freedom of expression, politics, human rights in certain categories. Is that a priority for the next American president? Can we actually have a productive role in telling the Chinese how to run their own business?
I think we have to recognize the political cycles because they're very real, as they are here in the United States. And there's a political cycle leading up to the 19th Party Congress late next year. And it carries with it this unprecedented anti-corruption campaign where 100,000 cadre have been rounded up, from Xu Caiho, one of the top military people, to some very senior party leaders, in fact, a member of the Standing Committee of the Politburo. So it's cleanup time within the party to rebuild it and give it newfound legitimacy in the run-up to the 19th Party Congress so that people once again believe in the only governing structure in the country. I'm not sure that I would have expected, and for you political scientists or observers in the audience, I don't know how you get through an anti-corruption campaign this ambitious without shutting off dissent and closing off dissenting opinion, which is exactly what Xi Jinping has done. My sense is that he's going to have to clean things up, steady the ship, moving into the 19th Party Congress next year, and then get back to the third plenum reforms, which were announced in late 2013. And you can all go and look up what those reforms consist of. Some of them were rearticulated as part of the 13th five-year plan. But my guess is that his second term, which will run from 2017 to 2022, post anti-corruption campaign will likely take into account the core elements of the third plenum, because he knows that, you know, first order of business is fix the party, second order of business is fix the economy or you're done. And there are certain aspects of the economy that must be addressed or they're going to be in real serious
Which state. Is in our interest also, of course, because this is an important theme of the president's, that our economies are so interdependent. Kurt, I just want to come back to you for a quick follow-up. You are concerned that the Chinese president might test the next American president, if I heard you correctly. Mm-hmm. Could you give us an example of what that could look like? And any thoughts about how the U.S. should prepare for a test like that?
Well, let me just say, as Ambassador Huntsman laid out, I think we have an interest in much of what President Xi is apparently about. I think the truth is the ballast in our ship, in the U.S.-China ship, is the health of our business relationship. And if you look at it from like 60,000 feet over the last 30 years, huge amounts of American investment have gone into China. It's created production capabilities and lots of exports to the United States, right? The next phase of our relationship on the business side has to invariably mean that more American goods and services are sent to China. Now, frankly, that process is not happening at the pace and has been blocked by a lot of domestic actors and the Chinese government in a way that it's not in our best strategic interests. And so it's not something that can wait 3 or 4 years. That process has to move more rapidly going forward. I do think that President Xi is trying to prepare for 2017, as Ambassador Huntsman suggested. The question is, this major anti-corruption effort, is it a selfless task designed only to go after those people that are most egregiously challenging the essential integrity of the party, or in fact are some political opponents simultaneously swept up in this? And I would say the jury's still out, but increasingly there are more concerns that there is an overlap and that in fact President Xi has taken steps to create remarkable power, a centralized power in himself, in a way that we have not seen in 30 years. And so, and you could say, well, that's necessary in this environment, and collective leadership does not serve China's best strategic interests, but it also makes China more unpredictable. The hardest thing that we face right now is that I find myself, I'd be interested to hear with the ambassadors, when I meet with Chinese friends at the foreign ministry or the state council, they're interested in meeting because they want to hear if I know anything about what's going on in their government, because they certainly don't. And decisions are being made by an incredibly small group of people in a who we don't meet in a small leadership area inside Zhongnanhai. And that is a big change from the past, in which we worked with institutions, had a pretty good sense of how China made decisions. I think President Xi has a few areas that he, look, the truth is we've worked on many more things, and there have been more accomplishments in the U.S.-China relationship than people realize. The climate change agreement, although some would say it does, climate change doesn't exist, this is a huge deal, it's very important, let's see if we can build on that going forward. The steps that the United States and China took after the global economic crisis were important. We took them each for our own interests, but there was some coordination. I thought that was very important. We never talk about it, but the management of the Taiwan Strait is essentially the fundamental recognition that both countries understand some of the issues that need to be kept in mind, and I think that has to be underscored as a sign of some progress. But also the Iran deal, but the challenges ahead are going to be in the South China Sea, in which China is challenging. I think sometimes it's hard for us to understand what this is about. People say, well, gee, it's a long way away, it doesn't really matter, and these islands. The truth is this area, this 9,000 square miles, about 40% of global commerce by tonnage and by value passes through this area every year. And the Chinese essential position is, look, this is our territory, and that really does not in any way comport with the law of the sea or any institution that understands legal parameters. And we will let you sail through this, but it's not international waters. That is antithetical to everything that the United States has stood for hundreds of years. So I think that is an area where we could have some challenge. The hope will be that China will understand its interests in not pressing the case right now and exporting this somewhat into the future. But the real issue is going to be North Korea. How North Korea plays out.
Hold that thought, because I want to come back to North Korea. Really important, needless to say. It just brings to mind an interesting question quickly to you, Fran. On this question of testing a new president, is this something someone in a job like yours in the White House is thinking about a lot right now? Is it a big part of the transition? To what extent is the government prepared for people testing? And it could be terrorist groups or nation states. But how high on the list of concerns is that?
So this was a concern going back to the inauguration of the first term of Bush 43. I was working in the Clinton administration, and I remember when he walked down Pennsylvania Avenue, I was sitting with Attorney General Janet Reno, because we were very concerned about terrorism then. Remember, it's less than a year later, we have 9/11. Yeah. So then you had the first peaceful transfer of power post 9/11. The Bush administration began the process for the transition to the new president about 18 months out because we were very concerned. And so the Obama administration has long begun and talked to those of us who served in the Bush administration about how did we begin that process so far out? What did we worry about? What were the things we looked at? It has now become public. There were direct threats to President Obama at the inauguration. And so you begin to think about legally who retains power until literally he takes the oath. What is the succession for the order of the presidency? Should anything happen between the time he leaves the Capitol and the time he or she gets to the White House down Pennsylvania Avenue? And people remain in place. It's little understood that folks actually retain their authorities, their legal authorities, in the outgoing cabinet until their resignation is accepted. And by the way, it's not an accident. That doesn't happen until the president makes his or her way down Pennsylvania Avenue and arrives at the White House for that reason.
So interesting, and it's a little off topic. You probably remember the Obama team had these false reports that there was going to be a terror attack on his first inauguration, Somali terrorists. It turned out to be bad intel that someone had planted, and I think he didn't get out of the limo or wasn't going to get out of the limo as a result. But of course, nation states contest, and Ambassador, you and I were at a dinner where the subject of Vladimir Putin testing the United States during a transition or before the election came up. Why don't we talk for a minute about Russia, which has come up in a couple of other contexts. And you and I were talking before we came out here about Ukraine, and I thought you had an interesting perspective. Let me first ask you what you think about what seems to me pretty close to a consensus in Washington that is opposed. You have a kind of overwhelming consensus with a minority opposing it, and that minority happens to include the President of the United States. The consensus says we should be sending weapons to the Ukrainians to fight the Russian-backed separatists in eastern Ukraine. The president strongly thinks we should not do that. I'm interested in anyone's views on this. Would love to have a debate about it, but why don't I go to you, because we had been talking about that, and the question of how the next president deals with this increasingly thorny relationship with Moscow.
First, I'd like to say that I concur with my colleagues on the need for resolving our issue of what is our role going to be in the world, because that's a kind of filter that needs to be established. And we had a good filter until the end of the Cold War, and we haven't had one really crystallize and solidify since. And we sort of therefore have to deal and an ad hoc basis responding to challenges and crises makes prioritization hard. Having said that, with regard to Russia, without getting into a grand strategy issue, I think that a reasonable approach, at least in my mind, is a combination of taking legitimate Russian interests into account, putting Putinism aside, as Secretary Gates was saying, but at the same time having leverage to incentivize Russia, or even in this case, since Putin is the head of it, to accept that reasonable approach. So I have advocated that we should not be willing to as a sign of desiring positive relations with Russia for Ukraine to join NATO, for example, that a kind of feminization of Ukraine is something that I think is not unreasonable within, while respecting Ukraine's territorial integrity. But at the same time, if Russia does not go along with that, although they are saying that's what they want too, that arming the Ukrainians should they persist in destabilizing or disintegrating NATO or disintegrating Ukraine or dividing Ukraine, that we should keep as leverage, because we always need to have leverage to be taken seriously, and therefore that would be where I would come down on the issue.
Amory, you introduced the idea of leverage earlier.
I did.
So is that the kind of leverage you would support and you think we need?
So we've been so polite, but now we'll have a little disagreement.
Excellent. Good.
Please.
You know, I do believe we have leverage, but I would not, first place, I would not accept the Finlandization of Ukraine. Finland hates that term, by the way, but neither would I necessarily send arms. I agree with Zal that you keep that in reserve. But the best thing we could do for us, for Europe, and frankly for Russia, is to support Ukraine economically and in terms of energy, in terms of actually providing a decent government in Ukraine. No easy thing. They've had lots of people who've tried, but what Putin is most frightened of is next to Russia evidence that you could have a popular revolution that throws out the dictator and then the country actually succeeds. That is his nightmare, and that is actually what we should strive to achieve. But the other thing is to take off on something that Secretary Gates said, which is Russia's playing an old game of pointing to external enemies to strengthen the government abroad. The czars did this, the communists did this, the Russians have done this forever. If we arm Ukrainians now, that in many ways plays right into his narrative. You know, the West is right there. It would be like letting Ukraine join NATO. So there again, we actually want to put the spotlight on the problems in Russia economically. We don't want to build Putin's sense of himself. We have to in the Middle East, because we have to deal with them. But we don't in Ukraine. And mostly what we need to do is work with Europeans to enmesh Ukraine, not only providing economic aid, but political support as they fight their battles.
Yeah.
And I would add to what Anne-Marie is saying, I think the next president is likely to be tested by Putin early. I think it's a first-year problem.
Right.
I think that you've seen with the annexation of Crimea and the military intervention in Syria, he feels unconstrained, unchecked, and he is going to test that new president to see if the new president will be more likely to check his power or not.
And what do you think that might look like going farther into Ukraine?
I think you've got to worry about Latvia, Lithuania, just based on their provocations and aggression. I think that the Baltics are at real risk here to be a test case for the new president.
And we have to push back really hard.
Ambassador,
really
hard.
And to keep the different regions of the world together, let's not forget that the testing that takes place by Putin of the new president will be interpreted in Beijing. Read through, analyzed, and they will then take pursue a course of actions or develop policies that are commensurate with our response. They'll learn something from that, and that will then inform how they go forward in the South China Sea or vis-a-vis North Korea or vis-a-vis Taiwan, where you've got a new administration that is moving toward greater Taiwanization. So you've got all kinds of interesting pressure points around the world, certainly the Asia-Pacific region. What happens vis-a-vis Putin and the new president will be interpreted by Beijing in a certain way, and that will inform them in terms of what their options therefore are.
Kurt, I think that Henry Kissinger once said the U.S. must never allow Russia and China to be allied together against it. Does that ring a bell with you? Regardless, is that a true statement, and is that something you see happening, and is that a priority for the next president to try to prevent, or a geostrategic threat for the next president?
Well, I think we've seen, if not a formal, at least a tacit alliance between China and Russia over the last several years. And I think they are united, at least in the current context, against what they view is an American role in the world that is not in their interests. And I think much of that was animated by what we saw in the Middle East, the sort of the Arab Spring, and a concern that the United States was going to take that further into domestic politics.
Just to be clear, you mean concern that the United States was promoting democratic uprisings that were overthrowing authoritarian dictators, and Putin and Xi think that they're next on the list if they don't do something.
At that time it was Hu and Putin, but I think that's the case. I think our particular interest, just let's say in Asia, is to have a situation where Russia's sole line of delivery into Asia goes through China. I don't believe that's in our strategic interests. I think even though we're in a difficult period with respect to Ukraine, I would be one that would like to see an improving relationship between Japan and Russia, for instance. They have not even concluded the Second World War. There have been some interesting diplomacy. I'd like to see that carry on. I think we have the potential to work with Russia in Asia in ways that are, Russia's been helpful in the six-party talks in the past on North Korea. They traditionally take a position on freedom of navigation that's actually closer to the United States than to China, at least in theory, if not always in practice. I don't think we want to be in a situation where Russia and China are playing tag team in Asia and the Middle East in ways that are antithetical to our interests.
Well, on that point, okay, go ahead and I'll ask you a question about that.
I think that one of our weaknesses, not of the panel, in terms of sometimes policy, is that we don't see linkages or relationships between issues, theaters, geographies, that we are in a kind of integrated world, and we deal with issues kind of in isolation from everything else. Like in Ukraine, we want an independent Ukraine with the right to join NATO, without saying what does that mean for Russian cooperation on Syria, for example. What does it mean in terms of Russia relations with China or Russia with Asia? I've had some discussion with the Russians recently on Syria, where they say you're playing several games at the same time with us. You want us to cooperate in one where you want something from us, but where we want something from you, you're saying no. So I think this looking at linkages that everybody's watching everything, and there are interactions and connections important, and I think at the highest level, one of our imperatives must be to avoid this China-Russia tag teaming, as was said. I think there are many issues, and among them, they are not all equal. Some are more important, and I think we need to, we lack that sometimes.
Well, let's stay with that for a second. That dovetails with the question I was going to ask. So you've spent so much time in that region, you've dealt with the Iranians a fair amount. We've not talked much about Iran, which was such a main subject in the second term, particular of the Obama administration. Russia is now exerting this new influence in the Middle East through its airstrikes in Syria. Putin seems to be trying to get his own version of the peace process off the ground and was on the phone with Netanyahu a few days ago. And is also allying with Iran. As you know, Russia was using an Iranian airstrip to launch airstrikes for a while.
Yeah.
So I guess elaborate on that a little more, and in particular, this is an opportunity to bring Iran into this conversation. Is there a kind of a Russian-Iranian axis forming in the Middle East? And I'll tack on one last bit to this. You were recently in Saudi Arabia. How do the Saudis feel about this? Their great nemesis, Iran, making this aggressive new friend in Russia. That's a lot to chew on, so I ask you to keep the answer brief as we're running out of time, but how is that changing the dynamic of the Middle East, and what does that mean for the United States? How should we react to that?
First, I think Russia is getting a lot of attention and influence from very little, in my judgment, which is from some military capabilities, limited in numbers that it has applied, that's been willing to use. Russia, compared to the United States, isn't really a competitor in the traditional sense. Look at the sizes of our economies. Other than military, people are not, and maybe some diplomacy help, people are not looking in the Middle East to Russia to deal with the many issues that that the region faces. I think that the region is suffering from what Secretary Gates said correctly, maybe multi-generational crisis that is within the Islamic civilization, which is produced in part that crisis extremism, on top of which is the geopolitical rivalry for who's going to be number one in the region, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Iran, to the sectarian issues and the issues of economic development. It is a complicated, difficult issue. What it means for us is to be obviously seek a balance of power among the regional players, in my view, and be engaged with everyone. I never understood why we avoided engagement with Iran while at the same time pushing back against policies that we don't like or supporting our friends that we like. And so while we should protect ourselves, in my view, against threats that emanate from this crisis of civilization, such as terrorism, we want to avoid being entangled in that crisis too much, because we wouldn't be able to solve it and it will zap our energies. We should avoid overextension. So the question is a very complicated dance of regional diplomatic engagement, pushing back against those we don't like by supporting our friends, but at the same time encouraging positive forces, recognizing that it will take a very long time for this problem to be solved. And where possible, cooperate with Russia. I think China may become more of a player over time. India may become more of a player over time. But my really maybe surprising to some of my friends, my greatest worry is that we could get zapped into this multi-generational crisis where great powers have declined in part because they have gotten themselves entangled in too many crises at the same time, bringing about overextension and decline.
Do you think Russia can play a constructive role in the Middle East?
I think Russia, you know, Russia has been historically a power in the Middle East, and it is much, Russia may be weaker now, but I think it's very significant, for instance, that Turkey turned to Russia. Now, talk about strange bedfellows. You know, Russia is obsessed with the, you know, fear of terrorism, of Islamist states, but suddenly is going to make a deal with Turkey. Saudi Arabia's talked to Russia. I actually think one of the consequences of Syria, failures in Syria, although there were never any easy answers, is that Russia is a real player in Syria again, in the Middle East again, and they can make a lot of trouble. Right? Even if they can't solve things, they can make a lot of trouble. I mean, I wanted to say a word about Iran, and also we always talk about Iran looking at it from this side of the world. If you look at Iran, you also should be looking at India and Iran. India's rebuilding a port in Iran, needs Iran's energy. China's supporting Pakistan, India's working in Iran. You've got a whole Central and South Asian set of concerns we haven't talked about. But I've been so critical of the Obama administration on Syria, but I want to maybe conclude my remarks. In 2009, President Obama said in his inaugural address, "We will extend our hand if you will unclench your fist." And he was talking to dictatorships with whom we had no relations. Now, North Korea, we haven't made progress, notwithstanding Kurt's efforts, but we started with Myanmar, and Kurt was essential to actually changing our relations with Myanmar, which means we have better relationships with all of Southeast Asia. And then Iran, and getting that deal, and we're not friends with Iran, we're not gonna be friends with Iran for a long time, but it's far better to talk to them. And then Cuba. Right? That's enormous progress. We now do have relations with Cuba, and although we've still got the embargo, I think that gives the next president the ability to talk to nations and work in regions that we have not had.
But you put your finger, and I'll come to you with this transition, Kurt, you put your finger on the one nut that hasn't been cracked, right? And if you think back to Barack Obama's famous debate with Hillary Clinton in 2007, the leaders he said he would meet with no preconditions, and Hillary made it into a big campaign issue, it was Cuba, Iran, and North Korea. He actually wound up making a lot of progress with Iran and North Korea.
Iran
and Cuba, but North Korea remains totally intractable, it seems. Mm-hmm. So, Kirk Campbell, then Ambassador, I'll go to you, and I think we're running out of time.
I'll just make
to put people on
two
notice.
Quick points.
How do we change the status quo?
As we've gone through this, though, I would just say what this tells us is that at the top of the list for the next president is to have a hierarchy. You've got to make some decisions about where you're going to focus. And for me, number one on the list is to rebuild some relationships in Europe. I think that is. Those are our critical partners, and the worries, the real worries of the right-wing tilt in Europe and sort of disengaging from the United States is at the top of the list. Then we've also heard clearly, we don't have a choice. We're going to have to focus in the Middle East and South Asia. I don't think there are any good options. I don't think there's any prospect of of doing anything but spending a lot of American treasure and troops. And I don't see very much upside, but we have to do some of it. And then only third really comes Asia, which I think I would agree is at the very top of the list. And the key is to find the wit and wisdom somehow to find that extra time on what really is about our future going forward. Yeah. I would say that my own sense is that there has been a profound failure with respect to North Korea. I think we've tried just about everything, but in truth, if you look carefully, what we realize is that we think of North Korea as being heavily sanctioned. It is not. Nothing compared to what we've done with respect to either Iran, Cuba, or Myanmar. And so I think what will likely happen is we will decide at the beginning of the next administration that there's going to have to be much greater pressure put on North Korea. And we will go to China and say, we'd like to work with you on this, but we're prepared to do this alone if you can't work with us. Now, I think there will be an attempt to capture and say, let's work with this in partnership. But in truth, China has never really been content to put pressure on North Korea. They have enormous power and prestige across Asia. There's only one country that seems to sort of systematically snub its nose at Beijing. It's North Korea. This will probably mean going after some financial institutions in China that have interactions with North Korea. North Korea is growing at the same time that it's supposedly under sanctions. We've got to put more pressure. We've got to use some of the lessons that we applied effectively in Iran on North Korea.
Does that sound right to you? Fran, you want to jump quickly, and then we only have a couple minutes left, and I want to go
to
John.
So two sentences, because I want to pick up on Kurt's point about the importance of the relationship with Europe and the conversation, building on the conversation about a provocative and increasingly aggressive Russia, because it's come up now in the presidential campaign. Let there be no doubt, based on the conversation up here, the importance of NATO. We haven't talked about it, we don't have time for it, but I will tell you, given the dynamic that you've heard described up here, the importance of our continuing investment and relationship in NATO.
Yeah. Ambassador, I think you're probably going to have the last word here. We have a couple minutes, but if you wanted to...
Wish I had that in the presidential debate.
talk about North Korea. Or if there's something else you want to get in, but I just to close the loop on that subject, I would be interested in hearing your take on the question of the rationality of this regime. So we heard Secretary Gates say that in the next president's first term, North Korea might be able to strike the U.S. with a nuclear warhead. There is that regime has a reputation, that leader has a reputation for being crazy. Is he crazy enough to start a war, to take a suicidal act, or is he actually all too rational, holds the cards, puts us in an impossible position? What do we do?
You know, I think ultimately it's a suicidal regime, and when you're dealing with a suicidal regime, they become pretty unpredictable in terms of how they're going to behave. But you know, you can expect the unexpected. When you blow off four nuclear weapons in the span of 6 years or 8 years. I think it's a plea for help by Kim Jong-un. This is not what a steady, thoughtful leader does. This is what a leader does when they haven't consolidated power, when they're having problems in the case of North Korea with both the party and the military. He's trying to get some attention, and I think that's a very dangerous and scary sign. And I think the Chinese are rightly picking up on it. I've noticed a change in Chinese attitudes from the days when Kurt and I used to sit down with Wu Dawei, their key negotiator around the six-party talks. I think they're enormously frustrated. Xi Jinping has not met with Kim Jong-un. He has met with President Park in South Korea several times, who just, of course, completed a round of very positive meetings in Hangzhou. So I think the Chinese increasingly are incentivized to want to help. They have the prospects for enormous instability right on their doorstep. So what do you do? You've got to make sure that we have enough pressure and leverage and a relationship with the Chinese such that we can stop the few billions of dollars left in coal and fuel and cash that are going into North Korea and stop the pirated goods, the drugs, the counterfeit U.S. dollars coming out of North Korea. There's only one conduit, and you've got to be able to deal with that. The broader issue is building trust with China, bringing South Korea and Japan into those talks so that ultimately a status of forces and a plan for unification in the event of a failed nation state can be thought out in advance and it doesn't become a complete disaster for Northeast Asia.
That would be an unenviable problem for a president to inherit. We could do an hour just on that subject, but we're out of time. Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you all for such a great conversation.
So, thank you, Michael, for moderating, and Anne-Marie, Kurt, Fran, Zal, and John. What a way to launch Perry World House. Thank you for that conversation. I can't but take another moment to thank Lisa and Richard Perry for giving us the gift that is Perry World House. This morning, Secretary Gates and UN High Commissioner Navi Pillay formally cut the ribbon opening Perry World House. But what will make Perry World House a success is you, Penn students, Penn faculty, and our broader university community. Your ideas, your perspectives, your energy. I invite you to come and join us at Perry World House. We want to draw on all that is Penn, its 12 remarkable schools and the people in them, to mix it up with thinkers and policymakers like those on stage from around the United States and around the world, and to come up with research that can and does make a difference. I'm proud to say the doors of Perry World House are now open. The conversations have begun. Come join us and let us together make Penn a global agenda setter around the world's most pressing challenges. Thank you for joining us today, and we look forward to working with you in the years to come.